So just as we're waiting for, maybe we'll give them a minute. I did want to take the opportunity to just mention that our last webinar in November was on the topic of the Stop 67 campaign around pension age. And since that webinar, there's been a significant development in the Stop 67 campaign. And I wanted to just let you know that. And that is that the government has published the social welfare bill. And in the bill, there is a clause which will repeal the increase in pension age to 67 on New Year's Day 2021, next New Year's Day, and will repeal the intended increase to 68 in 2028. So, as you know, the objectives of the Stop 67 campaign were to prevent the pension age from increasing on New Year's Day and to remove 67 from the primary legislation. So if that bill goes through, it's up in the Dáil for debate on the 9th of December. And if it is enacted, it does appear that we will have achieved both of those objectives. So I just wanted to give you that quick update on the Stop 67 campaign. And our IT people are indicating that everyone is in now. So I'm going to start today's webinar. So as I said, the topic for today is the future of collective bargaining. And we're joined by three leading field experts and practitioners of collective bargaining. We have 1 hour for the webinar. And with that in mind, I'm going to go straight to introducing our speakers. So we're absolutely delighted to be joined today by one of the leading trade unionists in Europe. That's Esther Lynch. Esther is the Deputy General Secretary of the European Trade Union Confederation, and she was elected to that position at the Vienna Congress in May 2019, having served for the previous 4 years as ETUC Confederal Secretary. In the ETUC, Esther's responsibilities include collective bargaining, social dialogue, wage policy, trade union rights, gender equality, and Brexit. She led the ETUC lobby actions for new legislative initiatives to improve working conditions, such as the draft Transparent and Predictable Working Conditions Directive and the Whistleblowing Directive. Esther is currently the lead negotiator of a draft directive on minimum wages. And that draft directive that she is negotiating deals with the whole issue of collective bargaining. So we're delighted that she is joining us today as the lead negotiator to take us through that directive and talk to us a little bit about the negotiations, but really to explain to us that if it were to be transposed, what the implications of that directive might be for the collective bargaining rights of workers in Ireland. And just to say that prior to going to the ETUC, Esther worked in the Irish Congress of Trade Unions as the legislative and policy officer there. She started off her involvement in the trade union movement as a shop steward, like many people watching today, I'm sure. And if the ETUC didn't keep her busy enough, she's also senior adjunct lecturer in law at the University of Maynooth. And I know that a number of her colleagues at Maynooth University and some of her students are joining us today, and you're very welcome. Our next speaker is Gerry McCormack. Gerry McCormack, as you know, is Deputy General Secretary here in SIPTU. Gerry is responsible for the private sector. He's in an elected role as Deputy General Secretary. Prior to that, Gerry served as Divisional Organiser of our Manufacturing Division and as a National Industrial Secretary of our union. Gerry is and is widely respected as an expert practitioner of collective bargaining. He has practiced collective bargaining at national, sectoral, industrial and firm level and achieved outcomes for workers that increased their pay and conditions. But he has also achieved collective bargaining rights for workers who had previously been unorganised. And we're delighted that Gerry is going to speak to us as a practitioner in the field on collective bargaining in Ireland, what it is, what it isn't, and maybe a word about what the future could look like. And then our third speaker, we're delighted to be joined by the Assistant General Secretary of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions. That's Owen Reedy, who's based in the Belfast office of Congress. Owen represents Ireland at the European Trade Union Confederation, so he works alongside Esther in the negotiations for the new our draft directive. Before going to Congress, he was an official here in SIPTU for many years. He's also, like Jerry, an expert in collective bargaining, closely associated with some high-profile disputes, which he successfully prosecuted in the public transport and waste management industries. Prior to going to Congress, he served as our divisional organiser here in SIPTU in the transport, energy, aviation and construction sector. And I suppose Owen is going to give us the benefit of his involvement at ETUC level in that directive that we'll be talking about. But also he's going to speak to us about how collective bargaining rights for workers in the Republic of Ireland compare to the collective bargaining rights of workers in other jurisdictions. So, for example, in Northern Ireland, in Britain and across the European Union. So we're delighted to have Owen join us as well. The format for today is we have 1 hour. The speakers are going to each speak on those specific topics for 7 to 10 minutes. Esther is actually going to use a PowerPoint presentation. And then whatever comes up in the presentations that the speakers make, I will ask them some questions on that. There'll be plenty of time for questions and discussion at the end, about 20 minutes. And the running order is that Jerry is going to go first, then we're going to go to Owen, then we're going to go to Esther, and then we'll have that plenty of time for discussion. If you want to post on social media about this webinar, please do. On Twitter, you'll see our posts already about the future of collective bargaining. So follow those, please, and you're very welcome to tweet yourself about the content. Okay, so that's all the introductions done. Everyone knows the format. And I'm going to invite our first speaker, Jerry McCormack, to speak to us about his experience of engaging in collective bargaining in Ireland, what it is, what it isn't, the difference between collective bargaining rights and trade union recognition, for example, and maybe a word about what the future might look like. So I'm going to hand over to you now, Jerry.
Thank you very much, Ethel. Hopefully everybody can hear me fine. And thanks very much to Owen and Esther for being with us here today. You're very welcome. And indeed, hopefully it'll help us have a really interesting discussion on this most important topic. As Ethel said, what I'm going to try to cover, and I'm going to try to do it as quickly as I can, is just what is collective bargaining and what it's not, how it actually works here in Ireland, and why it is important to us, why collective bargaining is something that trade unions really need. Now, I'm going to first off by apologising for those people who are practitioners in this area, who are experts in it. I know that you will know all of this, but I am going to take us through what, for those people who may not know it, what collective bargaining is, but also in a form that, that maybe people can understand, because we believe that not an awful lot of people understand what collective bargaining is. So what is the definition of collective bargaining? Well, there's an ILO convention, it's number 154, which sets out what collective bargaining is. So collective bargaining is, it's all negotiations which take place between an employer, a group of employers, or one or more employers' organisations on the one hand, and one or more workers' organisations on the other hand. So employers' organisations and trade unions. And what they do is they determine working conditions and terms of employment, and regulate relations between employers and workers, and the regulating between employer and organisations and worker organisations. So that's the definition, that's the legal definition of what collective bargaining is. As most people will know, collective bargaining doesn't have a legal basis in this country. We have collective bargaining, but unlike other countries, our system is the voluntary system. And I just want to explain what that is and how it would operate in practice. So what I'm going to do is take you through some of the terms that are used to describe collective bargaining in this country, and as Ethel said, is what is not collective bargaining. So you will hear terms such as trade union right to represent workers, workers' right to be represented by a trade union, union recognition, company union agreements, works agreements, workers' handbook. You have all these different terms. But in none of these agreements, you will see the word collective bargaining. It doesn't exist. So an awful lot of our officials, our activists and members are actually are working within collective bargaining, but they don't actually realise that it's there and it's not called collective bargaining. The word generally in a collective agreement that would describe it is probably something like negotiated rights. So if we typically say, for example, that a trade union, let's say SIPTU, for example, has negotiating rights on behalf of a particular grade group or category of worker within an employment. So we may represent the general operatives, and you may have another union representing the clerical, and you may have somebody else or another group of unions representing craft workers. So that just gives you an indication of what it is and what it's not. The other term you will hear is union recognition. And union recognition can mean a collective bargaining process, but it also may not. And by way of example, you can have a company who may recognise the trade union to talk to the trade union, have representatives, have elections, have people who will come in and meet management, who will have consultation, they will tell the representatives what's happening in the employment and so on. But they won't have negotiating rights. They are not actually negotiating terms and conditions of employment. And that is not collective bargaining. That is consultation and information. And you need to define the difference between both of those. So what we're really talking here is about a process of collective bargaining. So, as I said, union recognition does not mean collective bargaining. So just so as we understand what the different terms are and what they mean. So, as I said earlier, we have a voluntary system of industrial relations in Ireland. And what does that mean? What does that system look like? So, typically, and again, I'm apologising to those who go through this on a daily basis as part of their work, but for those who don't, just to give you a quick understanding of it. So typically, within your collective agreement where you are negotiating with an employer, you will start the process of local discussions between yourself and the employer. You will try to reach agreement on, say, a wage round, for example. And if you get an agreement, well, that's it. An agreement is done, put in place. And just to say that 95, 96% of all discussions and agreements between employers and trade unions happen at the level of the enterprise. They do not go any further than that. They are negotiated locally, dealt with locally, put into place, and that's the agreement. And it's a voluntary agreement. Okay. So if you don't get an agreement on a local level, then you would process it through to the state institutions. There are two institutions we would deal with in collective bargaining. One is the Workplace Relations Commission, the WRC, and the Labour Courts. So there are the two state institutions that we engage in if we don't get an agreement locally. So at the first stage during the Workplace Relations Commission, they provide a process of conciliation between the parties. So they try to reach an agreement between the parties, and if an agreement is reached, again, you have a voluntary agreement between the employer and the union, and that's put in place, and you move on to the next, you move on. But if we don't reach an agreement, then the matter is referred directly to the Labour Court. Now, the Labour Court, again, a voluntary body, it's a tripartite body made up of employers and union representatives and the state. They will hear the submissions from both the union side and the company, and out of that then comes a Labour Court recommendation. There is no binding end to it in the Labour Court. You can have a binding outcome, but you have to voluntarily agree in advance. So it's all a voluntary process. So when you get your Labour Court recommendation, the union or the employer can decide to accept or reject that Labour Court recommendation. Now, if it's rejected by either party, you then can engage or could end up in a process of industrial action or strike action. And that's the process that gets you through the process mechanisms within your collective agreement, which could end up in industrial action. So that's local level, that's Labour Court recommendations, that's how it operates. There's then sectoral bargaining that takes place. Not very much, but there is some sectoral bargaining that takes place. For example, we have joint labour committees. Joint labour committees are bodies that negotiate between employers and unions, facilitated by the state, that will have minimum rates of pay and conditions of employment for workers within a particular sector. Currently, we have two of them. One is in the contract cleaning industry, and the other is in the security industry. Now, there are lots of other joint labour committees, but because it's voluntary for the employers to participate in it, they don't actually operate. For example, there are joint labour committees that are set up, excuse me, for example, the hospitality sector, for restaurants, for agricultural workers, for retail workers. But none of them are actually operating at the moment simply because the employers will not engage in them. So while it is a process of collective bargaining, while the outcome of that collective bargaining is legally binding on all employers within that particular sector, unless the employers decide that they want to engage in it, again, we're back to this voluntary process and just employers decide not to participate in it. The next sectoral bargaining process that we have is called sector employment orders. A sector employment order is where, minimum rates and conditions of employment are put in place right across a complete sector. Now, an example of one of those is the sectoral organiser, the sector employment order that exists in construction. So all of the grades and all the workers within the construction industry have minimum rates of pay and conditions of employment that are enforceable in law. So it's very similar to, say, the European system that Owen is going to talk about later on. But again, it is limited. We only have a couple of sectors that have it. And one of those sectors, the electrical contractors, had a recent High Court case, people would be familiar with it, which struck down the SEO. And currently, the constitutionality of the legislation, the entire piece of legislation around SEOs, is gone before the Supreme Court, and we're awaiting the judgment on it. It's, as I say, is looking at the constitutionality of it. So while we have some basis for sectoral bargaining, some of it that could have a legal outcome, it's really not working for us. The fact that an employer can go in and go to court and get these pieces of legislation struck down is part of the problem that we have. And only yesterday we've been advised that the High Court have now an application from a group of security employers who are now looking to strike down the JLC for the security industry, which has only been, actually hasn't been signed off by the minister at the moment. Wait for the minister to sign off. Hasn't been signed off. So there's just a pure example of why the legislation is faulty. So, what about this issue about what is the rights of workers, the rights of a worker to join a trade union, or the rights of an employee to be represented by a trade union? So why is it important to us? Why is the whole area of collective bargaining important to trade unions? Well, first of all, if you look at workers who are members of a trade union in an organised employment, you will find, first of all, that the basic rates of pay are about 12% higher than that of companies that are not organised in unions. So it's very important. But secondly, that's not all of the picture. If you look at all the terms and conditions that are in a collective agreement that's negotiated by a trade union, and they are far along, they're actually the length of my arm if you wanted to go through them all, but typically you will have shift allowances, you'll have holiday entitlement, you will have overtime rates, and so on, sick pay, and I mean, there's a list, as I say, the length of my arm of different terms and conditions of employment that you can have in a collective agreement that non-unionised employments don't have. But it's also good for employers. There's statistics that tell you that where you have employments where unions are engaging with employers in collective bargaining, those employers are more efficient and have higher levels of productivity than their counterparts in the non-union sector, simply because they must be better, they must deal with the trade unions, so they find themselves being much more efficient than those. So that the non-union employers will tend to have lower rates of pay, lower levels, terms and conditions of employment, but they won't have the same levels of productivity as you will find in the unionized sector. So it's also good for our economy. So if you have workers whose wages are increasing on an ongoing basis with higher levels of pay, workers spend all of their pay. Workers have to. Because when they get their wages, they will spend them on a mortgage and their cars and whatever else they have to do. So the more money they spend in the economy, obviously the better the economy will be, the more taxation that the state will take from those workers. It is the fairest way to distribute wealth. It is the most efficient way to take wealth from capital and to distribute it throughout Labour. It also helps with social welfare, and it helps people who are less well off, because if a country's economy is doing better, then they can afford to pay better social welfare payments. You have better hospitals, schools, and so on. So it is hugely important. And as I say, it's a fair way of distributing wealth. If you have truly got a democratic country, a country that treats everybody fairly and equally, then workers must also be treated fairly and equally as well. We must have a collective bargaining system that provides for everybody. So workers must have the same rights as any other group or businesses. Employers, for example, you know, who are effectively trade unions, they have the right to represent their people. They have the right to go and talk to government. They have the right to negotiate with whoever they wish. But they refuse to give that same right legally to workers. If you want to look at some models, for example, that are good, and I know Owen might refer to them, if you look at the Nordic model, for example, where they have high levels of collective bargaining, high levels of union density, they also have the best terms and conditions of employment, the richest, the happiest, all of the metrics that you want to use of any country throughout the world. You know, and that is really where we need to be getting to. And that is because they have high levels of collective bargaining and high levels of union density. So the question you might ask then is, why are employers opposed to this? Why is the state opposed to this? Well, employers are opposed with the usual story, capital versus labour. The more they can have in profits, the better for the employer. So the less they have to pay out, the more that they receive for themselves. So shareholder value and so on. They want to have control. They do not want to have workers to have any control within the employment. They want to have total control themselves. So the state use the lack of collective bargaining in Ireland as a negotiating tool when they're negotiating to have companies come into Ireland to set up. They use it as a, to say, if you listen to any of the government ministers when talking about collective bargaining, they will tell you that it's an advantage to Ireland not to have union recognition or collective bargaining when they're negotiating against other countries. So that's, look, a very quick tour around what collective bargaining looks like in Ireland. I know it's a very simple form of what I've gone through, but it's just to maybe set the context and why it is trade unions want it and why it is important to us. So thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Gerry. And I suppose one of the things that is important for people to understand, and that you have taken people through there, is sometimes people discuss the union premium, you know, the advantage that unionised workers have over workers that are not unionised, solely in terms of the union premium on the hourly rate of pay or on wages. And as Gerry said, it's currently standing at about 12% in Ireland. But I think something to really take from Gerry's presentation there is that unions organise a whole, or sorry, negotiate a whole suite of working conditions. So working hours, overtime rates, bank holiday pay, shift patterns, represent people in grievances with the employer, in disciplinary hearings with the employer. So when you are assessing the benefit of collective bargaining, I think you have to think about it in the round there, not just in terms of the hourly rate of pay. And something we'll definitely come back to in the discussion is that whole point that Gerry is making that's not often stated clearly enough by the trade union movement. And that is the win-win that can emerge from collective bargaining. And that point that he's making, that unionised firms can be more productive, there can be benefits for employers, and we should not be afraid as trade unionists to discuss those aspects of the benefits of collective bargaining and the contribution that trade unionised employment and collective bargaining can make to productivity and to workplace innovation. So we're going to come back to some of those points in the discussion, and thanks for that, Gerry. I'm going to move on now to invite Owen to speak to us. And what we've asked Owen to talk to us about today is, if that is the situation for workers in the Republic of Ireland, how does that compare to the workers in other jurisdictions, the Northern Ireland, in across Britain, in the European Union, maybe even he'll want to speak about the United States. How do collective bargaining rights here compare to those countries? And the other thing that we've asked Owen to speak about is, in the last number of decades, but there's been an increasing number of employers in this country who refuse to recognise trade unions when their employees wish to be represented by a union, some very high profile employers. And in response to that, the trade union movement has lobbied for and negotiated and achieved various pieces of legislation, probably most notably starting with the 2001 Act. And it would be beneficial if Owen could take us through the various legislative developments, or the sequence of legislative developments maybe since about 2000, and also the impediments there. So the challenges, Jerry mentioned some of the challenges there that have been taken by employers to the various pieces of legislation that the trade union movement has achieved in order to expand and enhance workers' rights in the Republic of Ireland and collective bargaining rights. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Owen now. So thanks very much, Owen.
Thanks, Ethel, and very welcome this seminar. I think it's incredibly timely, particularly given that the EU Commission have published the draft directive that Esther's going to talk about. And I think it's timely that SIPTU, as the largest union on the island, is running with this seminar. I just want to, at the outset, pay tribute to the leadership of Esther on this, because I've seen her up close through my work, DTUC executive. And I think we're very fortunate, as we try and navigate this directive, that we have someone in the leadership of the Secretariat who understands the movement in Ireland and who understands the limits and what is needed within a directive to try and improve the situation in Ireland. And, you know, right across Europe, there are so many different systems, so many different cultures, trade union movements with different political backgrounds, and to try and build an alliance where we've now got 85% consensus is no mean feat, and I just wanted to acknowledge that. I think also it's really timely that we're talking about this now, coming hopefully as we are out of this pandemic with the vaccines, because if the pandemic has taught us anything, there are a few lessons, and the first one is the important role of workers and the importance of the world of work. And crucially, those workers who we now know that are essential, that we haven't valued heretofore. And I think for us in the movement here in Ireland, it is essential now we galvanise that momentum and that we insist that we achieve the ultimate right for workers, which is the right to be part of a structure that can enjoy collective bargaining, which, as Jerry has said, we don't have that right as a right here in Ireland to date. And I think Irish parliamentarians and political parties who see themselves as supportive of workers, supportive of enterprise and the world of work, and supportive of fairness at work, need to really get behind this directive, because it's a crucial issue for the trade union movement here in the Republic of Ireland. I would say on the island of Ireland, because there's no reason why a Northern Ireland Assembly couldn't seek to mirror progressive EU directives in the future when it comes to workers' rights, given that it's a devolved matter. Jerry has talked about collective bargaining in Ireland, and I think he's really summed it up very well. And I'll confine my remarks to the private sector, because the public sector has various forms of collective bargaining. And I think he's right. We have very limited routes and roads to collective bargaining in Ireland. And I'm struck and reminded by the comment of Andy Stern, the former leader of the SEUI in America, where he talked about, we either have the power of persuasion or the persuasion of power. So we either try and persuade a group of employers that they should engage with us because it's in their interest. And when we fail there, because sometimes we're dealing with employers who aren't enlightened and aren't progressive, we have to have the persuasion of power. We have to ballot our workers that we've just organized for strike. And really, is that what we want to offer? And we shouldn't find ourselves in that situation that we're obliged to offer that to a group of workers who've just been organized. I think it's fair to say our infrastructure in Ireland, as Jerry has described, is very limited. Over the last 20 years, the last two decades, we have seen some improvements. And I think it's a credit to the movement that we've made some progress. The 2001 and 2004 Act that essentially tried to create a situation where if an employer was out of line with the industry norm, by going through the labour court and by going through a various process, if we organised a group of workers, we could seek to achieve to bridge that gap on that norm, which was important to take wages out of competition, but also important to give workers that sense that they do have some access to collective bargaining. But we've had legal challenges to that, in the High Court and the Supreme Court. Likewise, the Joint Labour Committee and Employment Regulation Order System in the last decade, we've had a number of challenges to that. And Jerry highlighted the JLCs. There are 8 Joint Labour Committees currently, and as he said, only 2 sit. Two sit for, I think, 2 reasons. One, the Security JLC, I think, sits because of the foresight and leadership of people like Kevin McMahon, who are, sadly is no longer with us, and people like Christy Waters and Tim Daly, who persuaded the employers in that industry that it was in their interest to bargain at the Joint Labour Committee to take wages out of competition. It also suits employers in contract cleaning because it suits that business model. And I think it really requires us to have a frank, open and honest debate about our system and our model. And Jerry is right in his description. I mean, it is voluntarist. But the question has to be asked, who is it voluntary for? How many times have we examples of trade unions that have organised a group of workers, sought to have engagement with employers, had to go to the WRC or LRC as it was then, and Labour Court, the employer not to turn up, to achieve a Labour Court recommendation that says the employer should bargain with the union and nothing happens, and you're left with a situation where you have to try and use your leverage, whatever that is, or ballot for strike action. And I think this draft directive that Esther's going to talk about gives us the opportunity and space to have that debate. What type of model do we need in Ireland for the movement, but also for the economy? And I think it's also important to say that the draft directive, nor any other piece of legislation, it won't organise one worker. I mean, Article 4 of the draft directive talks about collective bargaining coverage, which is the number of workers that will be covered by a collective agreement, whether they're in a union or not. It doesn't deal with density. And I think that's a really important distinction. And obviously, we want to try and do both. We want to improve our density, the number and the percentage share of workers in unions, but we also want to improve our collective bargaining coverage. And the only thing that's going to address the density issue ultimately will be the refocusing, the reorientation of trade unions and their interests to run dynamic organic campaigns. Certainly the draft directive and national legislation can influence the context in which we operate in, but I ultimately think those two things are somewhat separate. On to the situation in Europe. As I said at the outset, there are a myriad of backgrounds and different systems in play. There are probably about, you could categorize them into 4 or 5 different systems. I think for us, and when you look at them coldly and clinically, the best system is the organized, decentralized system, which applies in countries like Austria, Denmark, the Netherlands, Germany, and Sweden. And these systems have, by and large, decent density in the private sector. I'm sure some of them would like higher, but they also have good collective bargaining coverage. So in Sweden, you're looking at 60 to 70% density, 90 plus coverage. Denmark, broadly similar. Germany and Austria, density a bit lower in the private sector, 20-30%, but coverage 60 and 90% respectively. But I think the crucial thing about those systems is, unlike our system in Ireland that Jerry accurately described, they have bargaining or forms of bargaining at multiple levels. And it seems to me in states and jurisdictions where you have bargaining at the local level and crucially at sectoral level, but also good national social dialogue, where the trade union movement plays a strong role nationally, at each of those 3 levels, you have better outcomes. You have better outcomes for workers when it comes to good agreements and better pay, but you've also better economic outcomes, as Jerry has outlined, it can be a win-win situation. And I think that's crucial. We need to look at that. We need to learn from that. And we need to use the draft directive, and in particular, the national action plans, if the directive comes through, to try and build capacity on that here in Ireland. And I know the TUC under Esther's leadership are trying to do that within the directive itself. Briefly and finally, if you look at, and Jerry touched on the whole issue of the difference between collective bargaining and mandatory trade union recognition, I think we need to get away from the debate about mandatory trade union recognition. It is certainly not a panacea, and it's certainly not the answer. We have it north of the border in Northern Ireland. Now, it doesn't work in Northern Ireland because to go to the industrial court to get recognition, there has to be 21 workers in the bargaining unit or in the firm. 90% of private sector firms in Northern Ireland have less than 21 employees, so it's redundant there. But look at the island of Britain, where coverage and density has gone down since that legislation has come in. And what it's done is it has upped the game of the employers who don't want to recognise trade unions. And I think to look at it, you also have to look at the United States of America, where through the National Labor Relations Board, you can have mandatory trade union recognition. Density is very low. It's nearly in single digits there. So I think there are crucial issues to look at across the board. And I think, you know, directive or no directive, there are things we need to do in the Republic of Ireland. We published a paper last year at our conference in Dublin, which talked about a roadmap and a route to reform for collective bargaining in Ireland. And briefly, there are three simple things we could do immediately, even without the directive, but the directive is crucial. First of all, we could change and amend the 2015 Act that would create a situation where employers who refuse to participate in engaging about employment regulation orders, we could bypass that first step. We could also amend the 1946 Act that would allow the Labour Court proceed with a draft employment regulation order in the other six JLCs that don't currently sit if the employers refuse to engage. And that would allow us to have collective bargaining coverage in retail, hotels and catering. And I think it would allow the unions in those areas have a platform to develop dynamic, organic, aggressive organising campaigns to build capacity there. We also need to look at public procurement as a crucial vehicle to try and drive collective bargaining. But the last point I'll make is this. There are debates to be had, and I think the one thing that I can say, there's a healthy debate currently within the Irish trade union movement at the executive and at the GPC. And what we're trying to do is mirror the needs that we have in Ireland with our collaboration with Esther and her colleagues in Europe. And the ideal scenario is that we have change and legislative change in Ireland, and that we have this draft directive beefed up and becoming a reality. Thanks, Ethel. I'll hand back to you.
Thanks very much for that, Owen. Yeah, that is precisely what we asked you to speak about. That's really, really helpful and insightful. And I think for some people, it will be surprising to hear that mandatory trade union recognition does not automatically result in increased trade union membership and density, or indeed in easier pathways for trade union organisers to organise workplaces. In fact, I think what you've just said, and it would be interesting to hear more about this if you do know more about it, that in Britain, since the mandatory trade union recognition legislation was introduced, that density has actually decreased. Okay. I mean, that is something that we really have to take on board in the Irish movement, because clearly, if that has happened in Britain, then we need to consider whether calls for mandatory trade union recognition legislation here would be the right route. And let's come back as well to that Congress paper that you mentioned, and those, you know, three actions that we could engage in immediately to improve the situation. So thanks, Owen. Okay, we're going to move on now to our keynote speaker. And as I said at the outset, Esther is the Deputy General Secretary of the European Trade Union Confederation, but for our purpose, and we're very proud of the fact that she comes from the Irish movement and that one of the leading trade union officials in Europe and the leading trade union official in collective bargaining is an Irish person and an Irish woman, moreover. So proud all round, Esther, of all of your achievements. And here in SIPTU, we also want to echo that point that Owen made, that it is so beneficial for the Irish movement that it is, in fact, you're leading the negotiations on the directive, because you have that expertise of the Irish legal impediments, having worked in the Irish movement for so long. But Esther, I'm going to invite you now, please, to tell us about this draft directive, to tell us about the negotiations, maybe to tell us about the timeframes that might be involved. And then also an issue that has emerged here, some of the parliamentarians have been in touch with us recently to say that the Joint Oireachtas Committee here on Enterprise, Trade and Employment, the members of that have been advised that there may be issues around subsidiarity here that they have to consider, and they've been given a time frame to report back on that issue. So if you had maybe an opportunity as well to comment on whether, in fact, the EU has confidence in the Republic of Ireland on this area, that would be great. So I'm going to ask Marius, who is supporting us on the IT side today, to open Esther's PowerPoint presentation now and invite Esther to speak. You're welcome, Esther.
Thanks so much, Ethel, and thank you for such a great introduction. It's so much pressure on me now, and the home audience is always harder because you can't bluff as much. Thanks, colleagues. I was just thinking, I was invited to speak at the ICTU Congress and to SIPTU's Congress, and at both Congresses, I talked about this ambition to try to ensure that the EU would bring forward a directive to deal with minimum wages and collective bargaining. And here we are, first report back to you. So thanks for the opportunity. First slide, please. So, colleagues, this is a picture created by the EU Commission. And I think it's a really important picture because it demonstrates that the narrative in the EU has changed. So if we took 9 years ago during the time of the Troika, this all would have been about why we need to reduce minimum wages, why minimum wages need to be competitive, and that would have been a very different picture. But there's a really important piece of information in here, which I can already reply to the subsidiarity question, because the subsidiarity question that's being raised is, why would you do something at EU level when you can perfectly well deal with all these problems at national level? And there's a simple, stark fact. The situation is not being dealt with properly because poverty, because of low wages, is increasing. It's increasing throughout Europe. The trajectory is the wrong direction. It's the wrong direction in terms of average wages, and it's the wrong direction in particular for people who rely on minimum wages. In-work poverty is increasing throughout Europe, so quite clearly the questions relating to subsidiarity, the argument that you shouldn't do something at EU level if you can do it better at national level, is blown out of the water, because the situation, if the EU does nothing, the situation will get worse. Minimum wages will go down, and the reason minimum wages are going down is because they're set compared to the medium wage. So the level of medium wages is set in comparison to other wages, and the level of collective bargaining reducing means that minimum wages are going down. So without action, things won't improve. And without doubt, the single market needs a fair set of rules, so that workers have confidence in it, and so that the other provisions of the treaty, Article 151, saying that there has to be an improvement of working conditions. There's lots of reasons why this, we can blow the subsidiarity argument out of the water. And don't be fooled by it, because the employers want to have an argument about legal technicalities. I mean, how distant from the actual facts could we get other than an argument and subsidiarity? This is not, like, we can't let this discussion be hijacked by that. This argument has to be about what it's really about. It's about exploitation based on a race to the bottom on terms and conditions of employment and on low wages. And how do you do that? By keeping the union out of the workplace. So for us at the ETUC, we're very clear. You can, there's no legal impediment to this going forward. The legal arguments are being raised as an excuse to divert from what's really at stake. Next slide, please. So the directive that the Commission has brought forward covers the whole of Europe, but it deals with member states quite differently. So if you have a statutory minimum wage, there's a set of obligations on you. And if you don't have a statutory minimum wage, then there's a different set of obligations. Not so relevant for colleagues here in Ireland, but my goodness, for the colleagues in the north of Europe, this is hugely important. So next slide, please. And they say all politics is personal. And for me, what this directive will ensure is that never again will the EU be able to show up anywhere in Europe and say to a member state, you have to reduce your minimum wage below a level at which it's adequate. And neither will the EU be able to show up in any member state and say, you have to remove sectoral collective agreements. So doing nothing leaves that danger there. Making sure that this directive is worded right and is adopted will actually prevent the role of the EU and the role of the ECB in enforcing wages down or in removing collective agreements. Next slide, please. So what have we won in this directive? Because this has been a long campaign, and I want to thank SIPTU for being part of it, both in terms of arriving in Gothenburg under the European Pillar of Social Rights, but also for being a strong example. Lots of SIPTU officials regularly come to ETUC events to explain the situation so well set out by Jerry and Owen. So first of all, it is a directive. We had a huge fight. They wanted a set of recommendations, but anybody who's ever fought exploitation knows recommendations are no good. You need law. We also have secured it's the right legal base, because the problem with the Laval case was the legal base was the wrong legal base, and that allowed the Court of Justice to go off and conclude that collective agreements couldn't be supported properly. So this is the right legal base, so we've ensured against that danger. It obliges member states to promote adequacy of their minimum wages and guarantees that unions have to be involved in that discussion. It obliges member states to take action to promote collective bargaining in circumstances where less than 70% of the workforce are covered by a collective agreement. It improves public procurement rules by ensuring respect for the wages in collective agreements in the sector or the region. So if you like, the going rate for the job will have to be respected in all public procurement. And it doesn't oblige any member state to introduce a statutory minimum wage. Next slide, please. But the fight isn't finished, because not only do we have so much opposition coming from employers and some governments, we also need to fight to improve it. So we need to fight to protect it, but we also need to fight to improve it. And that means, importantly, improving the definition, because throughout the Europe, we would prefer if collective bargaining was very clearly for trade unions, not for workers' organisations. We want to improve Article 4, where member states who don't have coverage of 70% of the workforce, they're obliged to sit down with the unions, so to sit down with ICTU and work out with the whole of the membership of the ICTU how will Ireland improve collective bargaining so that the coverage is increased. But importantly, the word increase is missing. So we need to get the word increase into that provision, so it's very clear that member states need to progressively move towards 70%. Article 10 is a supervisory mechanism that we need to include trade unions to be part of the mechanism. We can't have the Commission deciding whether collective bargaining is progressing without the absolute guarantee that trade unions are part of that consideration. And I don't mean some tick box consultation. I mean that we're part of a committee of experts who looks at that. Then the other piece that's missing is the directive says that member states must ensure that the minimum wages are adequate, but then doesn't really give very much direction or help about a threshold of decency. And then finally, there needs to be improvement to make sure that all of the loopholes that all of you could talk in detail about how workers have money taken out of their minimum wages, whether for breakages or for uniforms or all of the fake reasons that employers come up with to justify that type of practice is prevented. So in a nutshell, we've got a directive on the table. It's the right legal base. It has a good framework that we need to improve on. We fought off the argument that there is no competency to deal with this because it's setting pay. It's not setting pay, so the argument is over. And now the movement, now the move of the employers is to try and move into an argument about some complicated subsidiarity thing that will allow them to raise the yellow card, that there is no breach of subsidiarity because it's quite clear that doing nothing means the circumstance will get worse, which means that there needs to be action at EU level. And the, one of the conditions to argue against the subsidiarity argument is that you can only achieve the scale and outcome if you take action at EU level. And that is absolutely certain for the right to collective bargaining. So colleagues, that's where that's in a nutshell. I've gone very fast through it, but I'm happy to take questions, Ethel. I've kept me 10 minutes.
Okay, thanks so much, Esther. Can I ask you to expand on two things, please? So from our reading of the draft directive here in SIPTU, it is Article 4, which is the most has the most potential for improving the situation in the Republic of Ireland. So, and as I understand it, Article 4, if it was transposed, if it was well transposed, would require the Irish government to sit down with the social partners and agree a national plan that would bring collective bargaining coverage to 70% of the workforce. Can I ask you if that's correct? And then the other thing I want to ask is, what in practice might that look like? And is there, we know that collective bargaining coverage and trade union density are two separate things, but could that action plan improve the opportunity for trade unions to organise workers in the Republic of Ireland? Or is there any way at all that it could set us back? Because by setting statutory wages and conditions, workers may say to unions, do you know what, I'm going to get that anyway. It's a statutory provision, so there's no need for me to join your union. I know there's a lot there, but speak to us more, please, about Article 4.
What Article 4 does is it places an obligation on every member state that has below 70% of the workforce, so the whole workforce, covered by a collective agreement, to sit down with the national social partners and to develop a national action plan to promote collective bargaining. It doesn't require the attainment of the 70%. And remember, in some member states, you're going from 5% of the workforce. So 5% to 70% is big. But so one of the amendments we're looking for is to progressively increase. So in other words, so you have to reverse the current trajectory, which is down, to a trajectory that goes in the opposite direction. It doesn't say anything more than that at the moment. So one of the key amendments we're trying to have in this is to set out some of the enabling conditions that member states would have to secure. And one of those is the right of access, which I know is really important in Ireland as well. What we're also trying to do is to say that member states must have enabling conditions to secure the right to collective bargaining, because I want to get the phrase "the right," for obvious reasons in Ireland, the phrase "the right to collective bargaining" within that directive. Now, I'm happy to say that the colleagues from trade unions in Ireland and the ICTU are always hugely available to describe the reason why we need this. And that's important, if I can say why, because the type of resistance that trade unions in Ireland experience has so much more in common with America than the rest of Europe, that European policymakers say we don't need a law that does that because that doesn't happen in Europe. Now the type of experience that trade unions have in Ireland, the way in which I describe it to the European colleagues is that's what's going to happen if we don't fix and put a stop to it. If we don't stop what's happening and then change the trajectory, this is going to start happening all over Europe. So in fairness, the colleagues understand that, and that they are supportive. So currently, in a nutshell, Article 4, Ireland would have to sit down with the social partners and have a national action plan in place. If the ETUC can secure an improvement to Article 4, we would include what the key measures of an enabling framework that we would like to see within the national action plan. One of those being access.
Okay. And Esther, if the ETUC does manage to achieve the amendments that you're seeking, and we understand why you're seeking them, and if the subsidiarity block by the employers, because that really is what it is, it's employers maybe being employers, and I hope that the parliamentarians that are watching will see that that is what it is in Ireland also. If that is disposed of, what time frame are we looking at for the conclusion of the negotiations and the ratification for the directive? And then, because of your legal background, go on to talk to us about the transposition in the Republic of Ireland and the time frame.
So we wanted this directive faster, but we weren't able to get it faster, but it's out now. So the Commission, if you like, the Commission's role, which is to present the directive, they have now done that bit. But now it splits off in two directions. One is to the European Parliament and the other is to the EU Council. Now, the European Parliament, you would know all your MEPs there. They have yet to appoint a rapporteur, because I know that, you know, there's a lot of politics, as you can understand, at EU level behind this. So the Parliament has yet to appoint a rapporteur, but then the Parliament will say what amendments the Parliament wants. At the same time, and actually moving a bit faster, the EU Council, so all of the member states, so all of the ministers of Labour will be getting together in committees to say what amendments the Council wants. But the good news is the Portuguese presidency will hold all of those council meetings, and the Portuguese presidency understands the issues and is fully backing the trade unions. So we need to put every single bit of effort in so that by the end of the Portuguese presidency, all of the amendments we want have done all of the work to secure them, because it's unlikely that we will be facilitated in the same way in the presidency that comes up afterwards. So if you like, the best access, the best way that the best opportunity for us with the governments is going to be under the Portuguese presidency. So that's the next 6 months. So between now and the summertime is when we have to throw everything at this. And then at the end of the Portuguese presidency, the ETUC, with your representative Owen there, we'll look at where we are, because we shouldn't oversell this. We shouldn't say that we're guaranteed that all this will go well, because in the same way we're having discussions about how can we improve this from the point of view of a worker, the employers are having the same discussions. Number one, how do we kill this off altogether? Or secondly, how do we make sure that employers don't have to recognise unions as a consequence of this, and don't have to pay minimum wages? Let's make the governments pay the minimum wages. You know, so that's the discussions that we can imagine are happening on their side. But we have between now and the summer to put all of our efforts in. And really how every union member here can help is to meet with your elected representatives and exactly as Jerry McCormick set out, explain to them what's actually going on, because so many policymakers don't get it. So explain the problems that you're experiencing and explain why you need solutions for the union at national level, but more that solving things simply at national level, when so many of the companies are operating EU-wide, we also need solutions at EU level, and they need to be mutually reinforcing, not competing. So it's absolutely not a case of sit back and do nothing until the directive is done. It's get fully behind what Owen was talking about to get the national measures adopted, and by that to also get a better push for the EU level.
Okay, we've just hit the 1 hour mark. And for people who need to leave us now in an hour, thanks for joining us. And we'll see you on the December 1st Wednesday webinar. But because the discussion is still so engaged and there are a number of additional questions, I think if it's okay with the panelists and with Esther in particular, can you give us another 10 minutes, say, Esther? 10, yeah. Okay, great. Let's keep going. One final specific question to Esther before I go back to the other speakers. And that is this, Esther, that the world of work is changing so fundamentally in terms of digitization, in terms of the gig economy, bogus self-employment, bogus self-contract or contracting. And also the use of... also, workers becoming more atomized and dispersed, not least now with the potential for an increase in remote working after even after COVID. And one of the things that we're doing here in SIPTU, and I know other Congress affiliates are doing, is really trying to increase and improve our capacity to organize online and to use online and digital tools for organizing. Okay. Is the ETUC mindful of the changing world of work? When you say access, do you have a very traditional view of that access into a workplace? Or have you also considered a virtual access and digital access? And there is a definition of worker in the directive. Will that definition take account of gig economy workers? And will that be of any use to trade unions in organising those workers that might currently be referred to as bogus self-employed? I know there's a lot there, but you know.
So I can prove that we are taking on board the digital access to the workplace, because we negotiated one of the things I did early in the year just before COVID was I finished 9 months of a negotiation with employers at EU level on what's called an autonomous agreement. So this agreement concluded with employers at EU level a blueprint for a fair transition to digitalization at the level of the enterprise. And one of those was to guarantee to the union digital access. So if like the employers at EU level have signed up to that. One of the key challenges for unions operating in the hostile environment that you are in Ireland is, I know that employers probably haven't even said to you, let's sit down and negotiate how we implement that in Ireland. Whereas throughout Europe, you have employers saying, okay, we have this EU level blueprint for a fair transition in terms of digitalization that includes that. And so there are negotiations happening on the back of it. So the ETUC is absolutely on top of that. And as I said, we've negotiated a blueprint with employers at EU level in our digitalization agreement. Then the other question being the definition of worker, hugely difficult. And I don't see that there will be much improvement from what's already there. I'll be honest about that. Not because there shouldn't be, there should be. In my view, it says all the directive in its current form says all workers. It doesn't currently have like any exception or exemption. But I do know that when it comes to be transposed in Ireland, employers will say all workers doesn't mean all workers, and they'll come up with a whole load of definitions. And in fairness, employers are not alone in doing that in Ireland. I was talking to colleagues in Poland where agricultural workers are called help for the harvest. They're not even, the fact that they're working isn't even recognised. So there is a struggle all over Europe. And I suppose this is the final point I would make to all the lawyers who have joined, is that law is being mobilised against the people it's supposed to be helping. And I think that is particularly the case for employment law. Like it's been turned on its head, and our own demands are being used against us by a lot of innovation in law firms who have adopted a union busting approach. That what they're selling to the company is a service, the purpose of which is to use a range of legal arguments, of which the subsidiarity is just one of them. But it won't stop there. We're going to be faced with it. And I think there is a real role for the legal community who want to restore the meaning of labour law to its proper place, which is to be about protecting the vulnerable, protecting people to be able to organise in their union. And so I encourage everybody who's here today who wants to do that, you know, to be, you know, to find a way to support workers and their unions to address this outrageous attacks that are happening all over Europe around things like suddenly nobody knows what a worker is.
Okay, so what there's a call to action there for labour lawyers who are interested in workers' rights, and for academics who are interested in workers' rights. I'm going to let you take a breather there, Esther, and I'm going to initially put this question to Owen, but ask everyone really to comment on it. And that is that I know there will be people watching this webinar who are of the view that the employers keep taking us to the High Court and the Supreme Court and undermining our legislation and getting our wage setting mechanisms, knocked back. And that in that context, actually, it's, you know, that it mightn't, the directive might be fine, but actually what we need is a constitutional referendum. So I want to put that to each of the speakers, that there is that discussion also happening in the trade union movement. What is your view on that view? And also maybe to comment on whether you feel that the electorate is, if the question was put to the electorate, are they likely to vote for enhanced workers' rights and collective bargaining? And then I suppose also maybe Owen to comment on, you know, those people who argue for a constitutional referendum, is there a view on what exactly we would look to either have inserted into the constitution or removed from the constitution to improve the situation for workers? I know that's a big question, and it's really probably my last question to everyone because we're running out of time. So I'm going to start with Owen and go to Jerry and Esther just on that question of a constitutional referendum as a tactic.
Okay, a big question, but I'll try and be brief. Yes, employers have come to the courts to brick by brick take away the infrastructure we have. But obviously, if the directive were to come through, EU law is superior to national law, and that would address that issue, hence the critical nature of the directive. The debate about the constitution, I've heard a number of leading trade unionists refer to this as something that we need to look at, and I think it's a discussion that we certainly need to have, particularly as we come out of the global pandemic, where people's view of work and the world of work and those who carry it out, and the role of the state and its interaction with business and workers, I think people's views have changed, have softened on that to a large degree. So there's potentially a space to do that. But I mean, the reality is, if we are to embark on that, it is one hell of a campaign, the likes of which we would have to conduct that have never been seen before. So if we were to go down that road, we would need to plan and execute a very, very high-end campaign that would bring people with us. Crucially, our base, and I don't think our own base is even ready for that yet. A lot of work needs to be done with those workers who enjoy collective bargaining, so that they can see definitively the benefits. And you talked, and Jerry talked about the trade union premium, but it's much, much more than that. So I think that's a kind of a medium term project. I don't think it should be discounted. We should be ambitious, but if we are going to go down that road, we need to give it serious, serious consideration. What the question should be, obviously, is part of that debate. I have no views as to what should be inserted or what should be taken out. But if we're going to do that, it's a once in a generational situation, and we'd need to be really, really prepared in the way that we certainly aren't at any time now.
Jerry, we're under a lot of time pressure, so I'd ask you maybe briefly to comment on that same question of this potential referendum.
Yeah, look, it's the key question, really, in the whole debate. I love listening to Esther and talking about the potential of this directive, and it's brilliant, and the work that Esther and others are doing is fantastic. It doesn't resolve all of our problems in Ireland around collective bargaining. It would resolve some of them. And this question about a referendum, I don't think there's any choice but to have one. If we want to fix what has been happening in Ireland for the last decade, where employers are continually, as Ona says, brick by brick, taking down our wage setting mechanisms, well then we have no choice, I believe. The big question that you've asked is well, what should a constitutional amendment look like? Or is it an amendment? Is it an addition, or is it something that you take out? We're not altogether sure about that. Owen mentioned the group in Congress set up by the GPC, which is looking at this particular issue. And one of the main points that came across from that was that trade unions now need to engage in a process of discussing this matter within their own organisations to define what is it that trade unions want to come out of this. It's not altogether clear. If you look at a referendum taking place, even if you have a referendum and it deals with this constitutional issue, you still don't have collective bargaining. It's very much like the Repeal the Eight campaign, where if you repeal the Eight campaign but didn't have legislation to sit alongside it, well, you still didn't have access to abortion in Ireland, as you know. So you have a similar situation here with regard to collective bargaining. So there's a lot of work to be done on this. There's an expectation that we'd be leading into a campaign, possibly leading into the next election. Although with some luck, with this directive coming in, there may be an opportunity for the trade union movement to engage with government about some form of amendments that could be put in place by agreement. It's a possibility, very difficult. And there are probably divergent views, I think, within the employer organisation as well. But there's one thing that is clear, and Esther pointed it out, collective bargaining is the way to improve economies. It's a way to improve the rights of workers, the way to improve the wealth of people, the way to improve Europe. And it's also a way to diminish the increase in the far right that has been taking place right across Europe, where they are using people who are less well off and telling them that the fault is with governments and so on. We all know the story on it. It will assist us in that. So I think there is that clear understanding now across Europe, and hopefully the Irish government and Irish political parties will find the same thing. Big question, Ethel. We need to do a lot of work on it yet. I would hope that what we're doing in SIPTU feeds into what's happening in Congress, and that we will come out with a proposition that will deal with the constitutional issue, legislation issue, and how possibly this directive might be transposed into Irish law.
Thanks, Jerry. And final word to you there, Esther, on the referendum. Very quickly.
So the great thing about working at EU level is I can just dodge that question entirely. But what I would say is this, is that absolutely, if the Irish trade union movement is gonna run with that campaign, you can count on me to take my summer holidays to be in Ireland, to take every day of leave I have. I will show up and knock on doors to make sure that a referendum would be carried if you were going to choose to do it. But as I said, it's not at EU level. But thanks ever so much for having me, Ethel. I really appreciate it. It's given me the fight again, which is important.
Well, Esther, we were just delighted to have you. We're so proud of the work that you're doing on all of our behalf at the ETUC. We're going to stay in touch with you and try to support your work in any way that we can. I did hear you say that we will need to have members of unions engaged in the campaign. Certainly, I would want to say to members of SIPTU that we will be really coordinated about that we'll get our messages clear, that we'll have a campaign plan. And to say to Owen and Congress and the other unions in Congress, I do think that Congress should coordinate that campaign and that political lobbying so that the trade union movement is speaking with a single voice, if possible, on the issue. That would be the most effective way to engage in the political lobbying. Well, look, I think we could go on for hours, but this, what we have discussed for the last hour and a quarter, it was supposed to be an hour, is the single biggest issue confronting the Irish trade union movement: trade union density, trade union recognition, workers' rights and collective bargaining rights. So it has been fantastic to have the three of you involved. I know you have to go, Esther. We will stay in contact with you. Thanks very much, Owen. Thanks very much, Jerry, for your contributions. They were really insightful. Thanks for answering the questions. So honestly, just to say again, to reassure Congress that here in SIPTU, this webinar today is part of our workplace democracy campaign. It is a priority campaign for our union, and piece of work that we're doing within the union at the moment is exactly what both of you spoke about, which is discussing with our own members what collective bargaining is and isn't, and discussing with our own members the value and benefit of having collective bargaining rights as a trade union member. Because I suppose we feel here that trade union members need to understand the value of their own collective bargaining rights and their trade union premium. And that when they do that, then we'll all be best placed to talk to non-union members and the general public if we need to do that campaign around a referendum to extend collective bargaining rights. So Jerry and myself and John King and Joe Cunningham here will all continue with our workplace democracy campaign. We will work closely with Congress on the campaign for the directive, on the political lobbying piece, and in figuring out the future, the best future around a referendum or domestic legislation. You can be assured of that. So thanks everyone for watching. That's the end of our webinar today on what probably is the most significant issue confronting, the most significant question to be answered by the Irish trade union movement. Our next webinar is on Wednesday, the 6th of January, the first Wednesday in January, and that is on the topic of climate change, and specifically on the topic of a just transition, climate justice, and how that just transition has a very gendered dimension and affects women. So please join in. We'll be advertising it on social media on Wednesday, the 6th of January at 1 o'clock again, and on YouTube afterwards. So it just leaves me to say thank you again to the speakers, and thanks for joining in. And bye bye, everyone.